Thank you for lending your ear and everyone for inviting me up here to moderate this amazing panel. So thank you again for Asian Society and International Forum for putting this on. I would like to introduce tonight's distinguished guest. I'm going to start on the far end. And on the far end, I have a David Meader. David has been a business professor, consultant, and startup entrepreneur for universities and tech companies. In 2014-15, he traveled alone around the world for a year, 28 countries in all. In seven of those countries, he offered pro bono business consulting services to small social enterprises serving very low-income communities. He is writing a book called The Lean Volunteer to help adventurous business professionals do the same thing, find a solid social enterprise in an exotic country, and help them deliver on their mission by improving their organizational capability. To the middle, we have Yingzhao Liu. Ying loves sharing her love of culture and leads design efforts for emerging markets at LinkedIn. Ying is native to mainland China, has traveled to 30 countries, and always finds inspiration in people's creativity, spirituality, and everyday life. She's also a translator and an experiential educator and a resident at a Zen temple here in the Bay Area. To my left is Britt-Marie Alm. Britt has lived and worked internationally for much of the past two decades. And today she is the founder in CSS, that is a new chief title, chief string slinger, of Love Fest Fibers. And for full disclosure, she is my fiance. Based here in San Francisco, LoveFest designs and creates yarn and knit goods through partnerships with artisans in Tibet, Nepal, Cambodia, and home on the West Coast. And so those are our three panelists. So we're all here tonight because we understand the importance of traveling abroad to value and experience other cultures. And two, we all have experience or continue experience a job we're not terribly excited with. Yes, no, maybe. Okay. I myself have left a lucrative job as, I don't know, whatever you define as lucrative, but as Jen, with the program Chair of Asian Society, mentioned. And I've found through my travel and doing philanthropic work abroad, particularly in Cambodia, I found sort of a path, at least I define as fulfilling. So paramount, we all took that career break because we felt there was something missing, maybe something we need to redefine. So we weren't satisfied with our careers, all of us I'm speaking here, and we didn't want to settle, so something was calling to us, so we decided to travel and travel with a purpose. With that being said, we'll begin by asking our wonderful panelists some questions and get the conversation going. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you for the patience on the introduction. Okay, so for everyone and anyone that wants to start it off, briefly describe the aha moment. That is the impetus for the moment you decided to risk putting it all down to travel abroad. Where did you end up going and what are you doing now? So I'll leave that open to who wants to take a stab at that one.
Ben?
David.
I'll go.
All right.
The aha moment is I'm dropping microphones already. Okay. So my background has kind of been kind of an ADD career to start with. I've been professor, consultant, entrepreneur, and doing a lot of different things. So the aha moment for me was after teaching for MBAs. I've taught at Arizona and Cal and Mills. And teaching MBAs, how many of you are MBAs? Or been MBAs or want to be an MBA? Okay. For those, the thing about MBAs is they're taught how to learn, they're taught how to basically run organizations for other people. And so there are a lot of skills that are actually very useful around the world. My aha moment came when I was teaching at Mills, and I had been with a philanthropy called Silicon Valley Social Venture Fund, which had done, we invest in local nonprofits and do nonprofit business consulting for them. And so I had some experience doing that, realizing that the skills I had as a business person were directly translatable to small organizations. And I found out further that one of the problems for a lot of nonprofits in the world is it's relatively easy to collect money and raise money for what are called programs. those things that face the customer or the client. It's virtually impossible to get money or even help to support back office stuff. And I found this out when I was working in Peru doing teaching for in English in a place called Pachacutec, which is in kind of a shanty town north of Lima, and also in Cusco. And I realized that teaching kids English was kind of fun. There wasn't a lot of impact, because you're there 3 weeks and they mostly look at the stranger and walk away. And so I proposed to the local folks that we start teaching teachers instead of the students themselves. And so from that came a school that is now in operation now. And from that I had the idea, wow, there's a way to do leverage. And when I came back, came around for a couple more years and decided, I'm just gonna take a year and do this. Because you know, a professor can kind of start whenever they want to. Entrepreneurs can kind of start if they're between projects. Consultants, you know, whenever. So there wasn't a major thing I left, a big six-figure lucrative thing that I was leaving. It was more of a lifestyle that was fine and working, but it gave me some freedom. And at that point, I said, let's just do it for a year. I waited around to try to find someone to do it with, and nobody wanted to do it. So I went alone. I said, fine, I'm not going to wait. I read the Paulo Coelho books, don't wait, because you're going to be dead before you get going. And in fact, that's going to be the big quote on the book I'm writing. And I just went. I just said, let's go. So I got a ticket to Japan and just went. Had kind of a skeleton itinerary, generally followed. Ended up going to 28 countries, and we'll talk a little bit later, but there was a point at which I set some of this up so I could do consulting in a way that made the travel way more interesting, way more safe, and it actually had some impact that I think we'll talk about. But anyway, so my aha moment was kind of the culmination of all this and reading Paulo Coelho saying, do it now, because if you don't go now, who knows when you're going to do it.
I'll go with Ying.
I guess I'll go. So yeah, my aha moment, I was working in technology, and you could call it a lucrative career. This is in the first dot-com boom. So looking in hindsight, if I had about a house in the Bay Area, you know, 10 years later, it would be quite a different story. However, there was another opportunity cost, which is what if you don't travel? What if you don't follow your dreams? And I second the quote you mentioned. For me, I had the realization that if I waited until I felt fully ready to do something, I would never do anything. You have to feel that edge of when you want to do something, but there's some fear. There's something of like, yes, no, but do it anyway. So with technology, I was in India for a little while for work, and I found there's so much more in the experience of living abroad and experience a whole different culture that I asked my company to put me in India for like 6 months or a year, and when they said, no, that doesn't really work, you too much need it here, I decided to just leave. And I also decided to travel alone rather than wait for someone to go with, because again, like if you felt like all the conditions were perfect, then you'd be waiting a long time. So I started out evaluating graduate schools, but then quickly decided I'm actually more interested in sort of the education of life and the education of cultures. So instead of going to graduate school in Europe, which I did go check out a few schools, I came back to here and then sort of regrouped and repacked, went to Latin America, and then later to Asia and to Africa. So altogether, it's you know a few different continents and sort of different type of trips strung together. I certainly don't regret any kind of decision I've made. Often in life, you regret what you did not do rather than regret what you did. So I've also probably made the money back in a way in my career, because ever since then I've looked different on paper than any other candidate. So my travels actually led to kind of a niche career of working in international product. Now I lead design for international products for LinkedIn. I have people in China, in India, so I still travel to those places quite a bit. But also I have an international perspective, and part of my role is actually to educate various teams about how to design and to have empathy for international users, for international audiences. So it's something I very much deeply care about. And I'm also in a role of transforming people at my workplace, because they actually now in Silicon Valley, as I can see here, people come from everywhere, right? But we don't always bring our full selves completely to our work. So because I understand what it is like of that deep relationship that people have with their environment and with the full context, the rich context that we grew up with, I also have the perspective of how to encourage a rich, really rich and diverse workplace. So those are some of the things I do today.
So yeah, I would say the roots of my aha movement moment came really early. I was probably a sophomore in high school, sitting in social studies class and looking at a big topographic map of the world. And I saw this area that was dark, dark red, maroon, showing how high altitude it was, and it was the Tibetan Plateau. I had no idea exactly what it was all about, but I asked my teacher about it. I became totally fixated on it, and from that moment on, I wanted to learn more about it. And just a few months before my 16th birthday, I decided I really wanted to go to Nepal and Tibet, and I found a program to do so. And a great community service project absolutely blew my mind open. I couldn't sleep for the first few days because I was just so excited by everything I was seeing and what I was always hoping I'd kind of see by traveling in the world. And I think after that, that laid roots for me to see that I love to travel, definitely. And who doesn't love a wonderful holiday? But I really love traveling with a purpose. And so I really followed a blind interest and a blind passion in a region. And I can kind of continue to build on that today with each trip I've taken. So, you know, fast forward quite a few years, I've taken quite a few different career breaks throughout my career to leave for those regions and a few new regions as well. And the last big career break I did was I was working with a philanthropic consulting firm, and slowly on the side for the few years before that, I was starting to research a business that I was passionate about. So I wanted to bring together this love, this incredible love of textiles that I had grown over the years, as well as this love for a region. And how do I marry these philanthropic passions I have and these ideals and the things I've learned through the different roles I've had, and how do I marry that with my regional interests and also this interest for textiles? So I slowly researched and I found this beautiful products that I was super interested in, and also these communities that I could be helping through bringing their products to market. So I left my career and took the jump and have been doing that for the last year. But it definitely is one of those scary jumps you have to make. And sometimes interest and passion just have to blind the common sense aspect.
So to you, Britt, regarding scary jumps, what advice and learned lessons would you have, and for the rest of the panelists to follow as well? Do you have for someone looking to put it all down, take that mid-career break, first, second, third, fourth, fifth, whatever iteration of career break, and establish their career, then travel abroad into the unknown? What advice?
So yeah, two bits of advice, and they're contradictory, actually. So one of them, I would say that if you've been waiting a while and this is something that's really gnawing at you and you have that itch, you have to just go and do it, because there's never going to be a good time. There's always going to be something that keeps you more rooted in place if you listen to all those little bits of things that tie you to a place. But at the same time, if it is something like a business venture or something like that, I also say take time, research it while you are rooted in place, and then take the jump when the time is right. So if it is more of an itch and something that you just really need that head change, that life disrupting, daily grind disrupting, which so many of us get wrapped into, and you get caught into these often negative thought patterns, sometimes you just need to cut it and jump away. Because I do believe in the trite but beautiful saying that jump and a net will appear. And I've definitely done that on various occasions and found it to be incredibly rewarding, and found jobs and wonderful opportunities abroad that I never would have been able to conceptualize when I'm sitting at home worried about what was next. So I think that is probably the most important thing I've found there.
Definitely, always take the jump. Do small jumps in your regular life. Experiment with going out of the comfort zone, and then the bigger jumps will come easier. I work with a lot of young people, whether in hiring or mentoring, and often, especially those who come from more traditional cultures and families that want them to succeed, they often feel like they must do the right thing. They must do the right thing step by step by step to set themselves up for success later, and there seem to be a linear path. However, our world is changing so quickly that we just actually don't know where it's headed. There's no way to know. So rather than trying to plan for that, it's actually better to follow your instincts. I really like this quote that says, don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive, because what the world needs is the people who are alive. So, but even in a more sort of rational sense, recently I heard the founder, the chairperson of Sequoia Capital speak, who's that's a preeminent, you know, VC firm in this valley. And he says if he was young today and can learn Mandarin, he would be in China. You know, the gravity of the world is shifting, right? And we actually just don't know. It's massive change. So do the things that make you slightly uncomfortable, because that's going to happen more and more and more. So, you know, again, the opportunity cost, right? The opportunity cost of not doing anything is much, much higher than the cost of correcting a mistake. So, yeah, just, you know, and even on a pure financial sense, the cost of sitting in California and doing nothing but just paying San Francisco rent, you know, can allow you to travel anywhere in the world. Right, you don't have to make a dime. You can, you know, if you can make the rent here, you have a way, and people have skills too. You have a way to travel. Money is not really an issue. So yeah, the advice is, you know, take the small steps. Right, see how it feels. Research a place you're interested in. Email a couple of people or organizations. Right, start to simplify your life and make way for living out of a backpack for 6 months or 3 months or whatever it is. It's always harder to get started, right? That first leap is the hardest thing. Everything else that comes after is much, much easier. However, start to do a little bit of something, and then you will start to feel how that, you know, what kind of response you're getting, right, from life itself. And then that's gonna get easier and easier.
If I may interrupt, and to you, David, what would you recommend for someone who's maybe something new or anything, for someone who's doing a third, fourth break from a career?
Well, if you've done three or four breaks, you kind of know how to do it, right? If you're here today, you've made it. So you know that their transitions are just a natural part of life, and that I've been in San Francisco since 1980. Things have changed since 1980. My first programming was on punch cards, thank you. So things always change, and if you're trying to hold off and say, well, I better not do anything because things might change, well, they will change whether you like it or not. And the only thing that really matters is, what are you going to do with your life in the meantime? So if you're done it three or four times and you're kind of comfortable with that, you have to kind of find out what your fear is. I mean, is it a fear of disappointing people that might have an assumption about what you should do? Is it a fear that you're going to go off in there and people are going to hurt you or not want you? Like it's going to be scary or something or unsafe? Is it fear that you're going to try to make an impact and you're really not that skilled that you think and you're going to kind of screw up? I mean, figure out what the fear is. I can tell you right now, I went for 12 months. The whole thing, just to kind of get to the bottom line, I spent $48,000 out of my pocket for 12 months of everything. So that's $4,000 a month. Some of you may be paying close to that in rent, right? And I actually think I saved money by not making money and going on the road. I mean, take California state taxes and all that stuff and all the things you get. I get a $75 parking ticket for 5 minutes late. You know, it's costly to live around here. And so it might actually be cheaper, and I actually saw it as cheaper to travel, for one thing. I think the other thing you could... you kind of have to find out your fear and just kind of deal with it. If your fear of not being skilled enough, then figure out what they need. I can guarantee you right now that everybody in this room, anyone, you can find a small nonprofit or a social enterprise working in a lower income community that if you go with the right attitude and you bring your skills and knowledge and experience and thoughts and inspiration and soul, you'll find something to be useful. I guarantee it. And you can spend 2 weeks minimum trying to do something for them, and they will love it. Will it have a huge impact on millions of lives? We don't know. I mean, because any organization has strange impact. But I think if you want to go and you're thinking about it, find out what's keeping you back, just deal with it, and then at some point just pull the trigger and go. And trust that humanity welcomes you. I never had one situation, 28 countries, even when I arrived in Calcutta at 2 a.m. without any money, everybody wanted to help me. somebody stole my phone in Morocco. Okay, so I know who it was. It looked kind of like that shady guy in the Pink Panther movies, but had the hat, the fedora, and all that, broken fingers, the whole thing. But there's no downside to doing it, is kind of what it comes down to for me, if you're kind of drawn to it.
So that's a great segue into Ying's question about fear. Mm-hmm. So we're talking fear from a general sense. Particularly, let's address a specific fear, which is the skills gap. You know, someone takes a break, they fear that there's going to be this gap in the resume. And briefly describe those fears, maybe your own, and one how can hurdle that.
Fear is a human condition, right? It's natural to have fear. It's natural to have worries. And it's really the fear of the unknown, right? So the resume gap is you just don't know how you're going to compare to other people, right? It is a very competitive job market, you know, always, right? We define here in our society, especially in Silicon Valley, we define ourselves so much by our jobs, right? But what we do and what we create and titles, salaries, all those kinds of things, right? So of course, there's a lot of pressure. We live in a highly pressurized environment. And this is a little bit of a bubble, as I'm sure you guys are aware of, right? San Francisco, Silicon Valley, this is a very unique place. It's great. It's full of opportunity. However, just also realize that it's a little different from the rest of the world in so many ways, right? So it's actually useful to break out of this bubble once in a while because it's going to make you somewhat unique. You're going to have that perspective, right? I talk a little bit about helping my team or the people I work with have empathy for people who are not like them, right? I don't know how many of you guys work in in a innovation type of space or R&D. It's human nature to create things in your own image. So it's actually really good. It's going to make you much, much better. If you step out of your zone, you're going to become a better professional. I found this myself. I'm a designer. I'm supposed to be creative. And one of the sort of unexpected dividends of my own travel is I became a better designer because I could actually handle my own the pressures on me better. Because when you are doing design or whatever it is, there's a lot of unknowns. When I didn't like things that I didn't quite know how to do well, right? So I would tend to produce something that wasn't quite perfect, but I would stop iterating because that gets the pressure off me. So it's little things like that, or having pushback on other people, or just doing things that I wasn't comfortable with. But after the travel, I had a sort of confidence that I didn't realize that would be created or be part of what I would get from the travel, that I was able to sort of stay in that zone of discomfort more and explore and see what happens. It's hard to describe this, but the things I created that are visual were actually better. And not let alone that I was slightly better communicator and I could handle sort of challenging conversations more and I trusted people more. So I think in terms of the resume gap, there are interesting things that you get that overcomes any potential negatives about the resume gap. As a hiring manager, and I do a lot of hiring now, I actually look for people who have done interesting experiences. And I think many hiring managers would tell you this. One of the typical questions I ask for an interview is actually something like, what is the hardest thing you have ever done? Because what people define as hard is tells me a lot. And then how they looked at it and what did they do tells me a great deal, right? So like many people say, I'm sure you've heard this, right? Hire for the personal characteristics and then train for the skill. Our skills are constantly being, revamped, right? That can be done. But you want the person with the right attitude, with the right sort of outlook on life, and with the right sort of internal safety to do that. People have fears about going traveling, fear of being alone, fear of being sick, natural disasters. Am I going to find the things I was looking for? Do I have the skills to be useful elsewhere? Am I going to face pressures when I come back of not finding a job or family pressures of people not understanding? Would I still get along with my friends that I had different experiences with? you know, would I fall out of my friend circles? Do they have any idea of what I've been through? So those are all human fears, right? I'm sure there are many more. I don't know, like, you know, getting rid of your stuff, right? There may be fear there as well. There's a lot of things we're used to. But, you know, I'm sure many of you have heard, like, feel the fear and do it anyway. Because that attitude would go a long way, you know, not only in your travel, but all the journeys. Because travel is not only an exterior journey, it's also an interior journey. And I couldn't underscore that enough. And the experience of traveling, you know, many of you talked about already, like not having a concrete plan. I highly recommend that, as well as traveling alone, because the whole process of not knowing what's going to happen and then finding it happens in a much more magical way than one could have ever planned, right? Having the trust of strangers, you know, people do get sick, but somehow things actually turn out in a beautiful way. There's always kind of a safety net once you take the leap. So when you have that experience over and over and over, that internal safety net is always there. And then you can continue to take that leap every day.
I think, sorry, let me just build on that really quickly. I think the internal things that you accomplish when you're abroad are really strong, as Ying is saying. You know, you're pushing boundaries, and those boundaries stay pushed, and you grow, and you have those skills and that self-reliance that you bring home with you. And just as there are also things that you build foundations of when you're abroad. So here you've created a wonderful community and friends and workplace and the rhythm of life that you have here, but you can do that abroad as well. And I've found over the years now, I go back, I'm able to slip back into those things that I've created in other places. Like we've just come back from 5 weeks on a sourcing trip in Asia, and I go back to these communities that I gave to and they gave to me, and those relationships are there still and really strong. So I've looked at how fluid being here and being there are, and how that once you create something within, you know, real authenticity and integrity, those things remain in both places, and then you can go back and forth however you like. And those relationships are strong. I think, especially abroad, people are, the relationships I've created, I've been able to go back to year after year because I keep adding to them and investing in them. And so that's another thing. You're not losing home by leaving. You're gaining both places that you go, or all the places that you go, as long as you invest in them properly.
You answered a question I was thinking at the same time. So.
Fiancés, you know.
Okay, so Britt, she's fresh off a plane, as she mentioned, from a 5-week trip sourcing in Tibet and Cambodia. So welcome home. She left a philanthropic consulting company to start her own textile business, Love Fest Fibers. Number one, how did you work up the courage and start your own thing? Question number two, or suggestion number two, please describe how you've managed to align your business values with your passion for the Himalayan people. So that's a little more specific question.
Sure. Courage-wise, I think, I mean, it definitely took some courage, but it was such an itch that I had to fulfill. I mean, I really, really was excited about a product I wanted to produce. And I'll tell you, I had this entrepreneurial itch for a while, and there were a million ideas that I came upon that were just terrible or hilarious or maybe good, but do I want to make children's apparel or shoes or something for the rest of my life? Probably not. So there are things that have to really get you, and then they just don't leave you alone. They keep you up at night. And and those things have to be ones that you want to wake up and be working on. So there was this itch for wanting to be able to marry my life abroad and working with communities that I really care about, while also bringing in, you know, a business spin to this, as opposed to a lot of the nonprofit and foundation work I've done in the past. So it wasn't so much courage as just an absolutely insatiable passion. And the second part of the question was?
How you managed to align your business values with the people and serving those people in the Himalayas.
Sure, and I'll talk about tactics of this more during the workshop, because there are ways to go about this when starting what you hope will be a social enterprise. But the very nature of my business, and I source fiber, whether that be yak wool or alpaca fiber or recycled plastic bottle fiber or fashion industry remnants, quite a few different mediums we work in. But I've found that the most important thing is to look at what kind of impact on a community these will have, especially some of these natural grown fibers for communities that are losing their livelihoods. You know, synthetic fibers are becoming very cheap. The traditional livelihoods that people have are becoming economically no longer viable. So I was looking at how I was looking at both the problem that exists and also a product that I believed in, and found a way to align those and bring them to market. And another way to also be able to just be constantly traveling with a purpose, to be honest. It was just a way to marry all those things that that are most important to me into one profession.
Yeah, great. Anyone want to build upon that?
I think I'd be curious to hear a little bit more about how this sustains their livelihood there, and sort of, is it women's work, is it, you know, animal husbandry, is it connection with the land, you know?
Sure, it very much depends on the product. Some of it is, I'm working now, hopefully, to bring to market a beautiful hand-spun fiber, and so, you know, I had traveled to this area where nomadic populations are slowly being settled onto lands, and their livelihoods are no longer becoming that economically viable because there's not as many people are buying the yak fiber and some of the dairy products that they're creating. So I found ways for for me to work with a handicraft studio that is mostly primarily women spinning fiber, but then it also supports a whole community, which is an entire family, which raises the animals. But then on a very, more modern context, America has an amazing recycled fiber industry, and I wanted to also dig in at home. So it's not as profitable as the industry that exists in China and India, but that's exactly why we need to support it in America. So I started to work with communities here on the West Coast that are spinning fiber, and that's whole families running traditional mills, as well on the East Coast where they have recycled plastic bottle fiber plants, which is a wonderful industry to support. So that's a little in the weeds. We'll quickly withdraw from there. But yeah, if you want to talk to me more about it later, I'm happy to.
Super cool.
Yeah.
Great. All right, David. So you said you recently, during your intro, you took a 1-year sabbatical, right, to volunteer and build capacity for NGOs abroad. I think build capacity here is an important word, and you could expand upon that. So you hit 28 countries, as you said. Mm-hmm. So you're currently writing a how-to guide on being a meaningful traveler. Could you talk to the audience about the importance of building capacity and how it differs from volunteerism?
Sure. So volunteerism is a $1.6 billion industry. Over 1 million people go every year to do stuff around the world. And you've seen, I've used some of these businesses. They're very good businesses. It's going on. That's where people generally are working in customer-facing opportunities, like orphanages, teaching English, building buildings, doing stuff like that. And I did that. I taught kids English in these places. I've been part of my work with the Silicon Valley Social Venture Fund, which we invest in nonprofits in the Bay Area, is that for nonprofits and social enterprises together, it's really hard to raise money to do things other than program work, which is what I just described the client facing. In fact, a lot of organizations are told that they're fraudulent if they spend more than 15% of the money they raise on, like, managers or product. It's kind of like saying to Apple, you know, we want you to create really, really great products, but we can't pay your managers anything. But still, produce the products anyway, because that's what the shareholders want. And that's the kind of the insanity that's facing nonprofits around the world, and some of the social enterprises as well. So for me, the other option is, and that's already taken care of, 1 million people doing it. So the other part is business building, business process redesign, back office capacity building. In the nonprofit world, they call it capacity building. In the for-profit world, we just call it business process redesign, or kind of making the thing work behind the thing. That is really hard for small enterprises to get done. Most of these things are organizations are created by really smart, well-meaning folks that maybe don't have a lot of business training, or their staff doesn't have a lot of business training, and so they wing it. They do the best they can with what little resources they can. To have someone like from San Francisco area that's been working with leading businesses show up and say, hey, use me for 3 weeks. What do you want done? Their eyes get big. If you do it with the right presentation and the right kind of philosophy and attitude, you're gold to them, because when do they get a chance to actually work on logistics or work on reporting, financial reporting, or come up with better messaging for their marketing? They don't get that. And so for me, the big difference between programs and capacity building is that programs is kind of taken care of. I'm not going to worry too much about, but there is a huge demand and need for people in this room to go to these small enterprises, thousands of them, serving hundreds, thousands of families in lower income communities. They need help. And to me, that gets me fired up. You're talking about kind of the values. It's just, how do you leverage your 3 weeks in Tanzania to maybe have an impact on an organization that can use whatever you help them do, go on further? It's a whole lot better for me to teach the teachers than to teach kids. And I just love that leverage point. It just fits really well with the business values of what we can do.
Sure. Can anyone expound upon that teaching the teachers and that value?
I'll add just a little bit. Britt and I had met through an organization called Where There Be Dragons, which does experiential education and especially outdoor leadership too in developing countries. So I don't know if you guys know organizations like Outward Bound, but this organization have taken that methodology but added the sort of cultural component to it and training people to be world citizens. That organization is primarily focused on sort of, you know, one of the three goals of something like Peace Corps, which is more about educating the people here, enabling them to go out, experience something, and then bringing that experience back and becoming a better person, a global citizen in that process. They teach young people, sort of high school, gap year, college students, but they are also now training the educators. As I said, the gravity of our world is shifting away from the West, right? So teachers here need to understand something about the world, right, in order to train their global citizens. You know, the young people today are coming from so many different cultures. So if the teachers don't actually understand a little bit of that experience here, that's very hard for both sides. So I very much second teaching the teachers in so many ways. And teachers don't necessarily have just to be those in schools, but you know, so many people have sort of the role of facilitating or training, whether in organizations, you know, everywhere in the world, people have influence through what they know, through their expertise. So I just in general, I very much agree with if you have expertise, you know, spread it in some way, and that would have tendrils.
Yeah. Okay, so kind of touched upon about it a little bit, David, but coming from a Western business model, and we are all coming from that model, how can someone work in a lower income countries and not carry that savior mentality? And what damage might it do if you come in with that mentality? So for example, I'm coming in to teach you X, Y, and Z instead of doing a needs assessment to understand what is the need. And you said that in your comments is first coming out. Organization, what do you need? So.
Right, so one of the risks of coming from one culture and going to another culture and trying to transport some of the lessons is that you bring all the cultural biases with you. And very often those cultural biases get in the way of actually having an impact. You hear the word sustainability a lot. And what that usually means, in my experience, is locally, like in the Apache region of northern Uganda, whatever solution you come up with or they come up with, it works within them. It doesn't rely on outside parts. It doesn't rely on expertise they really don't have. It doesn't rely on resources they don't have. And so part of having the right attitude and not bringing your Western bias is to be able to get rid of all those things and just be open to whatever they want to do, you help them do it. If you see three guys, and this is what happened in this place in Uganda, there were three guys who were sitting over in the corner all day, and they didn't help, and I was getting a little grumpy. And I said, what? You know, you're paying these guys, they're not doing anything. And the guy pulled me over. Okay, here, ignorant Dave. So, number one, the general thing is nepotism is actually a good thing in parts of the world. If you have a job, then you want to get your cousins in there, you want to get your friends in there, you want to get them in there. So part of a mission for many social enterprises is to hire people. And it turns out that those three guys, two of them were actually disabled, and they were sitting there for a reason. They could actually do something, and they did things when I wasn't around, because I wasn't around all the time. And then there's another guy who was so skilled at what he did, he was only needed for 5% of the time he was there. But that was an important 5%. And so my ignorance was, I'm looking at these people and saying, why are they on the payroll? We're trying to keep costs low. And that was a Western bias of efficiency and all that, when in fact the values were very, very different. And throughout the world, you find those situations. Why is something happening that seems to us weird? Well, before you call it weird, find out if maybe it's the most brilliant way of dealing with a local condition that they could possibly think of. And then you say, okay, great, if there are going to be three guys over there and those two guys are disabled and they can't do anything, would it be appropriate to ask them to do something that they would find useful? Yeah, they might want to do a little bit more. They're kind of bored. Okay. And then you can start working it. So the whole idea is we are so used to efficiencies and capital markets and competition and, you know, meeting quarterly numbers that we miss the idea that a lot of organizations exist in the world to employ families and keep communities alive and to support each other, which we don't tend to do real well around here. So that's kind of what I would say to that opt. If you can go to places and have that open attitude, you get a lot more welcome.
Any further thoughts on that? I mean, I kind of felt that before and seen it, but you certainly encapsulated me. I'm nodding my head here.
Yeah, I think any traveler to a developing country is going to feel quite humbled in that way. Like, in many ways, we often feel that we know something, right? Because we're in some ways here, we are further in the development scale, right? And we feel like we've learned certain lessons, whether it's environmentalism or, better team culture, etc. However, there's innate intelligence in the way other people do things in their context, and it's very humbling. But that's one of the main reasons to travel, because that being humbled is there's wisdom, and you're uncovering your own wisdom in that process. We are indeed privileged here, right? But with that privilege, it comes a lot of pressure as well. So having that compassion for our own limited worldviews, our limited perspectives, is so important. You know, when I bring these young people to places like Western China, they often come from fairly privileged background. One of the schools I work with is Castellaya in Palo Alto, so extremely privileged young women. But you know, they go through something there, having rural homestays with you know, like no Western toilet, right? It's really challenging for them, and no language, no real communication. But they see the kindness and so on, and they are, and then we sit them down in a circle, and they're able to talk about things that they would never talk about here. Things like being bulimic and never sharing that with anybody. And that kind of, you know, we can say like they're a first world problem, but that's real suffering as well. They experience real suffering. And just understanding that there is all kinds of layers of the human experience is actually going to go a long way in helping them understand what's a human condition. And understanding themselves is actually the most important thing. And sort of giving themselves that latitude to be who they are is actually going to go a really long way to making them actually being able to be helpful in the world, whatever that may mean.
Yeah, I just to add to that, I think what I've learned in some of the settings I've been in a long time ago, and it's all being reiterated recently, is having less of an agenda and more listening. Being prepared to spend time with the people I'm working with lately has been really important. I've gone in with a lot of black and white ideas about fair trade, for instance, with my most recent projects, and seeing so many gray areas that I have to address by just really sitting and listening to people and understanding what they really need without going in with what I think is right, and then disrupting, for instance, a whole economy. Really big impact that I can have now in not so wonderful ways. And then back in when I was doing research or working with the foundation, I would go in with quite strong ideas coming straight from America, but then when I would get to where I was working, and particularly when I was working with Tibetan entrepreneurs in China, I found that I was learning so much more from them, actually, because I was so open and listening. Things that I still use today, and then was able to use some of the things I picked up along in my professional experience and share that. But it was that sense of openness that made it the most, I think, the most powerful.
Openness and listening is certainly a positive impact that people come in with. Is there an experience, Britt, that you came into a situation and someone did it right off the bat, if you want to share that positive experience?
That they were open?
Anyone came in, not just openness, other than that, they said it was like, wow, that's right on when you came in, it was a positive impact in the development work that you've done. So we're talking about, you know, the mistakes mm-hmm. that we all made, but how about some cases and examples where there was this positive impact? Right.
Yeah, I think, well, in terms of development work, it is you do see it again and again where people go in with the really open-minded scheme where they listen to what the actual needs are, for instance, not just investing in programs work, but seeing that in order for the programs work to be able to even get off the ground, the actual, you know, baseline costs for just running an organization need to be taken care of. Things that just take a lot of openness and needs, you know, correct needs assessment to really be able to ascertain. There are many examples that I wish that I could call to mind right now, but I've been impressed mostly by those that have been agile enough to change their plan regardless of what, you know, maybe if it's a funder or maybe a business plan, what it's led you up to, if you have to be able to abandon some of those things to really understand what needs on the ground are.
Great, thanks for sharing. So let's wrap up the last question with something a little less intense, a little more vanilla, as it were. So your best story or experience from traveling in the country you traveled. If you want to share a moment with everyone, and we'll start with David.
My best. They're all so good. Okay, I'll go back to Uganda, because it was a fun project. And it was set up through a friend of mine, Silke, actually helped set it up through Blue Planet Network. I identified a partner out there, and I was set up before I went to Uganda. I landed in Entebbe, had Franklin. I made sure one of my deals is, I said, if I'm going to work for you, you have to show up at the airport with the guy with my name on a piece of paper, just so I know where I'm going. So I went and I did some work with them, and I'm in northern Uganda and having a great time. I walk in. One of the things they asked me to do was come up with a curriculum for rural farmers to do entrepreneurship. There'd been a long process of drilling wells, which cut down the number of hours people had to travel to get water every day. So they've been so successful that now a lot of these villages had time on their hands. And so the next phase was, well, what do you do with that? And they said, we want to start new businesses. So instead of making $600 a year, we'd like to make $900 a year. And so they sent me and they said, I say, fine, I'll do it. I'm a business professor, I could figure out something, right? So they took me to this one village in particular, and I arrived there in a big truck. I didn't speak their local language. They had a couple interpreters, like two left languages. But when I showed up, I didn't know what to expect. All of a sudden, like 20 women come up to the truck and start screaming and dancing and singing. Wow. And they escort us into their village under a big tree, of course, where the rest of the village is sitting there waiting for me, and all the men are on a chair here, and all the women and children over there, and they dance, and they seat me, and they go through a variety of things with my interpreter saying, we're awful honored you're here, we're pleased, we'd love to help you, what can we do for you? Then a baby started to cry. Found out later the baby was crying because I was the first white man ever to visit their village, and the kid was freaked out. And so we have this wonderful conversation, and in the middle of it, they start doing another dance about how great it was that this organization I was with had drilled wells, and now that their families were getting clean water, and they were just thrilled. And then we talk some more, and then they dance me out. And again, the kid may be crying. And it struck me, this is year 2015, and if this sort of thing is happening, and there are these many people that are just on my reputation, I don't know what they explained I was doing, but just the reputation, is you feel connected, that we're not all separate, that we actually have things that other people want, not just because we're cool, but because they want their children to be healthier. They want their families to have hope in what their local thing is. And so that extra, if I was going to do anything to help them increase their income by 50%, $300 a year, they were thrilled. And it was just, you can't walk away from something like that, sitting in the truck saying, what was it? I mean, it was just incredible to a guy showing up, seeing, asking a few questions. But it was much more to them. And you get that all over, maybe not with the dancing. Well, sometimes. But I found that most every situation I showed up to, the people were deeply grateful that I was there as long as I helped them do what they wanted to do. So that was one great one.
A common thread in dance.
Dance, yes, with branches.
Sure. A travel story, not a development story, but it is a story about how our lives are actually influenced by the bigger political events that's happening in the world, and how also sort of a failure in hindsight is never quite a failure. So Timbuktu is famous for getting to, but it turns out it's actually even harder to get out of. So there's a famous festival, music festival there called Festival of the Desert. Big names show up, and African music is phenomenal. So, in Saharan Africa, you have to organize your own transport. So this time I was traveling with other people I've met. And we had wanted to do essentially a Saharan crossing from Timbuktu to Mauritania. So from Mali to Mauritania, kind of a 6-day Saharan crossing or something like that. Turns out I hope the recording's not going to get me in trouble, but there's American military training anti-terrorist maneuvers in the Saharan desert. So we were told, if you look like traveling Americans, you might be shot by the local insurgents. And if you put on Malian, the Tuareg people's costume and look like local people, you might be shot by the American drill army. And so there's long debates about what to do. And we actually did get local costumes made. And we were talking to different people, and there was, this Malian army colonel or something like that wearing a Hawaiian shirt, like amazing American accent, clearly trained in America. And then we were also taken to a sheik's house. And the houses there are really interesting. They have fine sand as a floor, and then Persian carpet set on top of it. So this sheik is essentially talking to us at the same time as people were massaging his hands and feet. And so clearly we were nothing. We were nothing compared to his powers locally. And we did pay a deposit of about $100 each for one of his guides to take us. But then eventually, after another quite a few hours debate, we just eventually had to change our plans. It was not necessarily safe enough. So sometimes, I talk a lot about overcoming one's fear, but don't be brash either. There are some things where you just have to change your plans, right? Mm-hmm. So we actually did have to give up that $100, which seems like a lot of money when you're doing sort of really shoestring travel, adventure travel, right? And do a whole different route. But that created the other adventures. And so just seeing how the local players were and how the power differential was so different from what we expected. There are things that we had access to that we would never have access to before, even if we were not able to cross the Sahara. So you never know what happens, but it was a delightful escape of a sort.
I'll piggyback on those great stories about the kindness of strangers, which is always what touches me so much about travel stories. It's a recurring theme for sure. But I went to Tibet University in Lhasa to learn Tibetan language, and I was traveling to a holy lake, and it was a couple days' drive, and I had jumped on this public bus by myself. I was feeling good about it until the driver started to drink, and then I felt a little less great about the whole thing. And we were stopped at a truck stop, and I was thinking, how am I going to get off this bus? This is not going to go well for me. And I started to think about the emails I'd have to write home about the injury that was incurred and all the sort of thing. And I met this wonderful family who was driving a tractor, and with the little language I had at that point, befriended them during this truck stop and decided to stay. They invited me to come with them, which was going to be a little bit ways up the road, but not all the way to my destination. And they took me up to their nomad tent, and we spent the night. And that also put them in danger because Tibetan families are not supposed to be having foreigners in their homes. They took me in for the night, fed me, children in my lap, just a beautiful evening. And they took a really special painted scroll, and they gave it to me as a gift. And then they drove me 2.5 hours each way, all the way to where I was going the next day. And then they went all the way back on their own. I was so touched by that. They didn't expect anything from me at all. There's so many parts of the world still where things aren't so transactional. But I was so touched. I was so young and so vulnerable at the time, and just so touched by the kindness there. And always remember them. Wish I had a way to contact them again, because they definitely made an impression.
All right. Thanks for the stories. That was quite interesting.
Got lots of them.
Got lots of them. So if you want to hear more stories, stay tuned. You will have exclusive access to each of these wonderful peers. I'm not going to call them speakers as much as they're your peers. So before I wrap it up, just some moments I gleaned, and this is why, if you were looking at me, I'm fiercely taking notes. if I may, just some quotes and thoughts. Briefly, regret what I don't do rather than what I did. Is that correct? Skills are translatable, build capacity, freedom. Paulo Coelho, right? Do it now.
Oh, Paulo Coelho, yeah.
Coelho. Okay, sorry. I apologize, Paulo, wherever you are.
Probably it now. Brazil.
Okay. marry passions with your career. Follow blindly. What is your fear? That's an important question to yourself. Follow your instincts. I'm reading my notes and they're kind of chicken scratch, so I'm going to skip that one. Business building, back of office building equals building capacity. Teaching the teachers. Think locally, be humbled. Common threads. Music, food. Adapt and flexibility. Kindness of strangers is not limited and not transactional. So I'll leave you with that. And on behalf of everyone here in the Asian Society International Forum, please give our hand to our speakers.